What's up, fellas? I'm back from Los Angeles. And again, y'all made a liar out of me. I'm spoiling y'all. If you remember in my last video a week ago today, I said the earliest I was going to do a video again would be tomorrow, Tuesday. But I'm coming to you on Monday evening. Mainly because, you know, I'm still getting feedback from some of y'all. A lot of it positive, not all negative. Definitely more positive than negative, but, you know, still got interesting comments. People wanting to challenge me on stuff, debate with me on stuff. You know, I just find it, some of y'all comments in my comment section. Now, I've had to delete a lot of shit. And I told y'all a few videos ago, about a month or so ago, that if people come in my comment section writing stuff that's just stupid, number one, it ain't got nothing to do with the video, it's just stupid, I'm deleting it. So I'm telling you that right now. I'm giving you that warning again. If you come in my comment section and you start talking about something that's either blatantly insulting, that's just I could deem stupid, or at bare minimum, it just ain't got shit to do with the video that you're commenting on, ain't got nothing to do with the content of the video, then 99% chance I'm deleting it. And I've had, in the last week, I've had to delete some like probably like at least 15 to 20 comments, man, because they fell in one of those three categories. Either somebody just came in my comment section hating on me, delete. You said something just stupid, delete. Or you said something that was a total digression away from the contents of the video, delete. So anything that falls in them three categories, I'm deleting, man. So if you commented and you saw a few minutes after you commented, posted your comment, you said, damn, where's my comment at? I could have swore I commented. I deleted your shit. And I'm always delete your shit. And in worst case scenario, I'm going to block you. There's a lot of people I've blocked from commenting in my comment section. Man, I got to tell y'all, man. Y'all know what I'm about to say about coming back from L.A., man. I just talked about this a few videos ago. Man, it's almost depressing, man. Coming back from warm, well, it wasn't all that warm. I was going to say warm weather, but truthfully, it wasn't all that warm in L.A. It was actually pretty cold, at least by L.A. standards. It wasn't, by Chicago standards, it wasn't cold, but by L.A. standards, it was actually cold in L.A. So it wasn't exactly beautiful weather out there. Matter of fact, it was raining. Out of the 5 days I was out there, it rained like, I want to say, two or three of those 5 days. Yeah, I got out there on Wednesday morning, late morning, early afternoon on Wednesday. It didn't really rain. Yeah, it was raining Wednesday. It rained Wednesday. It rained Thursday. And it rained Friday. Saturday was pretty nice. Saturday, it wasn't raining, but it was cold, at least at nighttime. But it always gets cold in the wintertime at night in L.A. Sunday, it drizzled a little bit, but it didn't really rain. But anyway, yeah, man, I always have fun when I go to L.A., man. Always, man. Always have fun when I go to L.A. And as you know, that's where probably my highest number and highest percentage of clients are, at least one-on-one face-to-face clients. I don't know if I would say all clients, but specifically as far as clients who tend to hire me for my one-on-one face-to-face coaching. Yeah, that's where my highest number. Now, I want to clarify, though. Not every client I work with in Los Angeles is from Los Angeles. I pointed that out before on one or two videos. Sometimes there's two, real quick on my one-on-one face-to-face coaching sessions, there's three ways I do it in terms of location. Sometimes a client will come to me in the Chicago area. They'll fly into Chicago. And I will work with them in Chicago, like either downtown Chicago or suburban Chicago. The second option is I fly to whatever city they're in. I fly to whatever city they're in. Or the third option is we mutually agree to meet in a city that, you know, both of us think is ideal. Like, I don't live in that city. They don't live in that city. But like a few cities in that example was, I remember in December, late December of 2017, I worked with three one-on-one face-to-face coaching session clients in Las Vegas. And two of my three clients that I work with in Vegas, they didn't live in Las Vegas. We just met there. They wanted to come there and visit. And so two out of my three clients that I work with in Vegas, they didn't live there. But one did. Then another time was, if you remember last year in 2018, what was that, around Memorial Day weekend, I worked with two clients in Miami, and one client, he lived in Miami, but the other client, he didn't live there. He just decided to go there because he had never been to Miami. And there's been a few other cities where I've done it, like Los Angeles. Sometimes I've had clients come to LA that didn't live there. But yeah, I've gone to LA. Here's the advantage. In case you're thinking about doing a one-on-one face-to-face coaching session with me, if there's one advantage to Chicago and Los Angeles is that a lot of times I don't charge you for travel expenses. I don't charge you for my travel expenses. You got to pay for your own travel expenses, obviously. But in terms of my travel expenses, I don't charge you. Obviously in Chicago, because I live in the Chicago area. So I don't charge you. So that's a given. But a lot of times, because I go to LA so much and I know so many people there, that's like I consider it a second home. A lot of times I don't charge my clients for like hotel expenses, air travel. But most other cities, not only do I charge you for coaching, but I charge you for travel, particularly if you're the only client I'm working with. Now, if I work with two or more clients in the same city, I waive the travel expenses. So that's a benefit to remember. Anytime, usually 90 to 99% of the time, if I work with two or more clients in the same city, I will waive the travel expenses. But if I had a client who lived in Seattle and he wanted me to come out to Seattle and I couldn't find a second client to work with, then not only am I going to charge that client in Seattle my coaching fee, but I'm going to charge him for my like hotel expenses and my air travel expenses. So that's something to keep in mind for those. Because I've seen people come in my comment section every now and then and inquire on my one-on-one face-to-face coaching. One more quick note on that, because of course I get a lot of questions. Like, one more common question is, Alan, what's the significant benefit of doing one-on-one face-to-face coaching versus, say, a Skype or telephone consultation? When I'm working with you through Skype or telephone, I can exchange, you know, I can drop a lot of knowledge, wisdom, insight, and advice on you, but I can't really study you. Even though I might be able to see you on Skype, I still can't really study you. Like, all of my clients who work with me one-on-one, they know, man, the first thing I do is I study you. I study almost like everything about you. Like, I study the way you use your eyes. I study the way you walk, the way you talk, everything. Everything about your body language, the way you dress, I study you. I have you work with one or more of my improvisational actresses. I have you do role play sessions in one-on-one, particularly my 8-hour and 14-hour. I have three one-on-one sessions. I have a 4-hour session. You don't do role play with the 4-hour session. Then I have an 8-hour session. You do some degree of role play. Then I have a 14-hour session over 3 days. And I have you do role play. The role play is generally designed to help my client distinguish between, say, a reciprocator and a manipulative time waster, which a lot of my clients usually think is easier to do than it actually is. I've had a lot of clients, they thought that would be easy and it ends up being much harder than they thought. Similar one would be distinguishing between an erotic hypocrite and a rejector. Again, a lot of clients tend to think that's easier than what it is. Then the final example I would give is distinguishing between a wholesome pretender and a cock-teasing manipulative time waster. Not just a manipulative time waster, but a cock-teasing. I mentioned, you should remember that. I mentioned that on one previous video. That's one of my hardest distinctions for clients to make, is the distinction between a wholesome pretender and a cock-teasing manipulative time waster. A wholesome pretender and a cock-teasing manipulative time waster. Man, I'm telling you, see, a lot of guys, but some guys come into my role play sessions thinking they'll be able to easily be able to distinguish between those different archetypes, and 90% of the time, they can't. Particularly that last one I said, I've had a lot of clients, when I had them do role play where they had to distinguish between a wholesome pretender and a cock-teasing manipulative time waster, a lot of them were like, man, Alan, that was way more challenging than I thought it was going to be. Man, that was tough. And see, that's what emphasizes, when I do those role play sessions, that's when you really see the true value of the Mode 1 approach and the true value of having top-notch verbal communication skills. That's when you really see it in action, man. And I've had a lot of guys say that. They say, man, I didn't really realize the true value of Mode 1 in general, and more specifically, the true value of enhancing your verbal communication skills until you have me do those role play sessions, man. Because, yeah, man, those are the things that a lot of guys confuse. And see, I don't want to get into a long thing about direct versus indirect again, but see, that's the weakness of indirect, man. When you indirect, man, I guarantee you, I put money on this, man. When you indirect, you have a much harder time distinguishing between a reciprocator and a manipulative time waster, particularly if there's time constraints. Like, say, I give you only 5 minutes to do it, or no more than 10 minutes to do it. Usually, the absolute most I'll give a client is 15 minutes. That's usually the absolute longest I'll give a client to do it, is 15 minutes. A lot of clients can't do it, man. A lot of clients can't distinguish between a reciprocator and a manipulative time waster within a 5, 10, 15 minute span. A lot of clients can't distinguish between a rejector and an erotic hypocrite in a 5, 10, 15 minute span. And they definitely can't distinguish between a wholesome pretender and a cock-teasing manipulative time waster in a 5, 10, 15 minute span. And but yeah, I help men on their body language. I help them with their eye contact. I just help them with a lot of stuff that I really can't achieve or accomplish through a Skype or telephone consultation. So yeah, that's my most expensive coaching. And yeah, and I went out to Los Angeles. I worked with two clients this past trip. I had 1 4-hour session with a client, and another client did a 3-day 14-hour session. On my 14-hour session, I do 4 hours on day one, 7 hours on day two, and 3 hours on day three. And so going back to feedback from some of you guys. There was one feedback a guy gave me that I found interesting. And he said he didn't have a problem with me reading it. Hold on. Some young sister just commented in my comment section on one of my videos. She said, I actually have to admit, I like this guy. I appreciate you saying that, sister, young sister. Yeah. Okay, man, while I'm looking at him, here's one of the negative ones, man. Well, I don't think he intended for this to be negative, but since it's right in front of me, I don't have to paraphrase it. I'm gonna read it word for word. I want to call him out. Man, I don't know if I'm gonna call him out by name. I should, but I'm not. But here's what he said. He said, "Alan, your Mo-1 method seems nebulous to me." For those not familiar with that term, nebulous means like vague and ambiguous. That's essentially the same thing as being vague and ambiguous or abstract. Nebulous. He said, "Your Mo-1 method seems nebulous to me. Even as I read your books, I know you don't always straight up come up to women and only try to attract them with sexuality and without verbal banter, teasing, etc. I get that the most sexual approaches you have, you can just suggest exchanging orgasms. Even they give you shit, it's annoying. I don't understand that. But you don't talk about real examples of sexual tension at all in your books." That's the key comment. He said, you don't talk at all about real examples of sexual attention, creating sexual tension in your books." Insert doll face here. Now, I'm not going to go off on you, young man. I was tempted to. I ain't going to lie. I was tempted. But if you saw my reply to you, I asked you a simple, straightforward question. I noticed you haven't replied to it yet. And the simple question was, I said, do you own a copy, either an ebook copy, a paperback copy, or the audiobook copy of my book, Ooh, Say It Again? Because the real deal is, anybody who owns Ooh, that's what that fucking book is about. That's the main thing Ooh, Say It Again is about. And I would say to a lesser extent, Mo-1. But definitely Ooh, Say It Again, that's all Ooh, Say It Again is about, is creating sexual attention. I keep wanting to say sexual attention, sexual tension, sexual tension. I mentioned that in one of my chapters in Mo-1. I talk about sexual tension. I talk about sexual tension. But I definitely emphasize that in Ooh, Say It Again. So for you to say I don't talk about real examples of sexual tension in my book, I got six verbal seduction stories in part two of Ooh, Say It Again. Not one, not two, not three, six. In part two of Who Said Again, I had six verbal seduction stories that emphasize the concept not only of being verbally direct with women and verbally seductive with women, but that emphasize creating sexual tension with women. So if you own that book, there's no way you can make that comment if you own that book. There's no way you can make that. So that lets me know that 99, either one or two things. Either you don't own Ooh, Say It Again, or if you own it, you ain't really thoroughly read it, or if you got the audiobook version, you ain't thoroughly listened to it. Because Ooh, Say It Again is all about sexual tension. That book is all about sexual tension. So, you don't know what the fuck you're talking about, with all due respect. And again, I know you didn't mean your commentary in any type of malicious manner, but yeah, you're off base with that, man. Who said again is all about sexual tension. Here's a comment of the guy who wrote, gave me some interesting feedback. Guy named Travell Brown. "Alan, I don't know if you'll get this, but I just want to say that Mo-1 has saved me. Mo One has saved me. I was interested in a coworker, and when I got her out of the work environment, I was very Mo One with her verbally. She expressed her interest in me as well. She then straightforwardly told me that she had herpes. I feel that me being Mo 2, if I had been Mo 2, I would have been at a higher risk for contracting her herpes virus. Thank you for how to verbally be upfront and straightforward. Fellas, Mo 1 helped me avoid an STD. This man is doing God's work. I appreciate you, Travail Brown. I appreciate you. I particularly appreciate you making that comment. He said, this man is doing, you know, the first person who told me that in a lighthearted manner was, you've heard me mention, there's a late great comedian named Patrice O'Neill. And one of Patrice O'Neill's best friends is named Dante Nero. Dante Nero hosts a podcast show, or at least I think he's still hosting. I don't know. I haven't checked in a while. But he used to host a show called The Beige Phillips Show. The Beige Phillips Show. And he interviewed me once on his show, and I interviewed him twice on my Blog Talk radio show, Dante Nero. But yeah, I remember when Dante Nero interviewed me on his show, The Beige Phillips Show, Fire Truck. That's what he said towards the end of the interview. He said, I don't know if anybody told you this, Alan, man, but you're doing God's work, man. You're doing God's work. And I kind of laughed, but when I thought about it, I ain't going to lie. It is true. Yeah. He said, man, you're doing God's work, man. Helping out these dudes, man, who's struggling with women. He said, I consider that God's work, man. Yeah. So there was at least one other, but I don't feel like searching for it now. There was one other comment that made me just shake my head that somebody had in my comment section. Damn. See, I got so many comments, man. Honestly, it'll take me too much time to look for it. But I'll tell you two general comments I can't stand. And I've talked about these before, but I'm going to touch on these, if only briefly again. Two just real simple general comments that just kind of mildly irritate me. One, I had somebody, I think at least two people come in my comment section and make a comment along the lines of, Alan, I don't know why people treat you like you're providing some really uniquely special, you know, knowledge or wisdom. When it all is said and done, Mo 1 is really just about honesty. Mo 1 is really just about honesty. I've been getting that literally for probably the last 15 years. I've had different people say that. Mainly guys. I really hear women say that, but guys will say that. They'll say, Mo 1, when it comes down to it, Mo 1 is really just about you encouraging men to be honest. That's actually not 100% true. And I've pointed this out multiple times before. That's not true. And here's the reason why. And I did a video where I emphasized this in a longer, more detailed manner in 2017, but I'll briefly reiterate it again. If you were to say Mo 1 is only about just simply about being the idea of being honest with women, three, not one, not two, three of my four modes of verbal communication center around honesty. So if you're going to say my book is just all about honesty, well, which mode are you talking about? Because Mo 1 is about honesty. Mo 2 is about honesty. Mo 4 is about honesty. Actually, of my four modes of verbal communication, the only mode that really centers around dishonesty is Mo 3. Mo 3 is the only of my four modes that center around dishonesty. But three of my four modes center around honesty. And see, that's the unique thing about, if I say so myself, that's the unique thing about my book, is that not only do I divide verbal communication distinguishing between honest and dishonest verbal communication, But even under the category of honest verbal communication, I distinguish it at least three different ways. For example, mode one is bold, upfront, provocative, straight to the point honesty. It's not just honesty. Mode one is bold, upfront, specific, provocative, straightforward, straight to the point type honesty. That's mode one. Mode two, that's polite, pleasant, well-mannered, cautious, vague, and ambiguous type honesty. Polite, well-mannered, pleasant to the ears, cautious, I think I already said cautious, and vague and ambiguous type honesty. That's mode two. And then mode four is just like angry, bitter, insulting, antagonistic type honesty. Angry, bitter, insulting, harshly critical, antagonistic type honesty. So three of my four modes center around honesty. So for anybody to say that mode one is just about honesty, you're not being specific. You're not being specific. Because again, three of my four modes of verbal communication center around the concept of honest verbal communication. But the question is, what type of honesty? There's different types of honesty. See, and a lot, that's the difference. A lot of books do just emphasize, you know, be honest. Like Mark Manson's book, Models. That's the main gist of his book. He just simply encourages guys to be honest. But he doesn't go into specific detail on what type of honesty. See, I go into specific detail on what type of honesty, the pros and cons of different types of honesty. So, you can scratch that general assessment of, mode one, all it is, I don't know why people treat it like it's rocket science. It's just all about being honest. No, motherfucker. There's a difference between mode one honesty, mode two honesty, and mode four honesty. All three of those are about honesty, but they're all three different types of honesty. You understand that? A similar comment, at least one person gave my comment. He said, some guy said a similar comment. He said, Alan, your book is not the only book that talks about direct versus indirect. I can think of at least one or two other books where the person who wrote the book talked about direct versus indirect. See, that's another thing where I have to say that's not 100% true. Because, again, going back to my four modes of verbal communication, there's two of my modes that center on being direct and two of my modes that center on being indirect. So I don't just simply divide verbal communication. Just like I said, I don't simply divide verbal communication into honest versus dishonest. I also don't simply divide verbal communication simply in terms of direct versus indirect, because I have two forms of each. For example, both mode one and mode four center around being direct. Mode one and mode four are about being direct. Mode one is when you're direct in a more confident, highly self-assured, smooth, and seductive type manner. That's mode one type direct. Mode one is when you're direct, verbally direct, in a confident, highly self-assured, smooth, and seductive type manner. Whereas mode four is when you're direct, verbally direct with women in a more insulting, antagonistic, harshly critical, angry type manner. So those are two different types of direct. Same with mode two and mode three. Both mode two and mode three center around being indirect, but they're two different types of indirect. A mode two guy is indirect in the sense of being vague and ambiguous. Matter of fact, that's my second or third most viewed video of 2018 is my video where I talk about that vague and ambiguous versus blatant dishonesty. Yeah, there's a video I have. That's like either my second or third most viewed video for the calendar year 2018 was my video called Vague and Ambiguous versus Blatant Dishonesty. Yeah, mode two is when you're indirect in the sense of being vague and ambiguous. Again, for those, most people are not know what that means, but for that 1% that don't, to be vague and ambiguous means you're honest, but you're not specific. For example, if I went to a restaurant and said, and the waiter said, "Hey, sir, welcome to XYZ Restaurant. How may I help you?" And I said, "Man, I am really hungry today. I want something really that tastes really good in my stomach." Am I being honest? Yes. So that would be the positive thing. I'm being honest, but I didn't specifically tell him what entree I'm interested in eating. So in that sense, I'm being vague and ambiguous. I let him know I'm hungry and I want to taste something good, but I didn't say specifically like I want the fried chicken or I want the pork chop or I want the ribeye steak or I want the shrimp or I want the lobster. You know, I didn't say anything specific. I just said I want something good and tasty to eat. That's being vague and ambiguous. That's what a mode two guy is. Mode two is when you're vague and ambiguous. So if you let a woman know honestly that you wanted to have sex with her, which would be good that you're honest about the fact that you want to have sex with her, but you're not specific about whether or not you want long-term versus short-term sex. You're not specific about whether or not you want monogamous versus non-monogamous sex. See, that's mode two. That's mode two. You're vague and ambiguous. You're not dishonest because, to put it in simple terms, let's say your objective was casual sex. When you're mode two, you don't straightforwardly tell a woman that your interest is casual sex, but you don't straightforwardly tell her that your interest is not casual sex. You leave it vague and ambiguous. So that's mode two type indirect. Whereas mode three indirect is when you just flat out blatantly mislead a woman or lie to a woman about your interests. So if your objective was casual sex, but you blatantly lied to a woman and told her that your interest was a long-term, strictly monogamous relationship when you know you're lying through your teeth, that would be mode three. You're just flat out lying. Anytime you blatantly misleading and or deceiving a woman about your desires, interests, intentions, that falls under mode three. But if you're just vague and ambiguous, that's mode. So anyway, bottom line, I have two modes that center around direct and two modes that center around indirect. So nobody can just simply say it's about direct versus indirect. Side note. Now, most of my Patreon subscribers have seen my 21 convention presentation from 2017. Not last year, but the year before, 2017. But Anthony Johnson, the chief organizer of the 21 convention, he just released yesterday. He just released my presentation from the 2017 21 convention. And you'll see that in the comment section. You'll see the link for it in the comment section. Yeah. So I've been getting a lot of good feedback on that. Yeah. You know, my claim to fame, of course, most of you know this already. Yeah. In the 10-year history of that event, I was the first African-American speaker they ever had. Yeah, I was the first African-American speaker at the 21 convention. I wasn't the first non-black speaker. Non-Caucasian speaker. They've had a non-Caucasian speaker before. They've had an Indian speaker before, and I think an Hispanic speaker before, but they had never had an African-American speaker. I was the first African-American featured speaker that the 21 convention had ever had. So yeah, they released Anthony released the free version of my presentation. Trying to think anything else I want to talk about before I get to the meat. This should be much longer than it's already been, but main thing I want to touch on, I'm still getting feedback. Some of you guys, man, I was just talking about my comment section. I'm going to tell you, man, if it wasn't for there's so many commenters that I love and respect their feedback and commentary, and there are quite a few guys who I love and respect and welcome their feedback and commentary. But if it wasn't for those group of guys, I would be like a few other people on YouTube, such as like Stevie Dean Williams. If you go to Stevie Dean Williams' channel, he'll see. Have you ever been to a YouTube channel where it says comments for this video have been disabled? That's how Stevie Dean Williams rolls, man. He doesn't allow comments. Yeah, he doesn't allow comments for his videos, man. Yeah, man, it's like for every, I don't know what I want to say. I'd say for every 3 to 5 good comments I have in my comment section, I always have some just bullshit comments, man. But anyway, this is going to be something I kind of already touched on a few videos ago, but I'm going to touch on again, man. Simple question, man. Why are you all trying to make excuses for your lack of balls? That's what I want to know. That's my real, just straightforward question. Why do so many of you men always want to offer excuses and or justifications for your lack of balls? Because when it comes down to nitty-gritty, that's all you're doing. Of course, you don't. A lot of you guys don't want to own up to it, but that's what essentially what you're doing. You don't want to own up to the fact that you just don't have the balls to be mole one. So because you don't want to own up to the fact that you don't have the balls to be mole one, what you try to do is you try to demonize my mole one approach. You try to disparage my mole one approach. Or at bare minimum, you try to add these invalid qualifiers. Invalid qualifier. What I mean by invalid qualifier, and again, I touched on this a few videos ago, when you say things like, well, yeah, mole one might be effective, but I think it's only effective for this type of guy. For this type of guy. Or only think it's effective on this type of woman. Or only think it's effective in this type of situation. Those are what I call invalid qualifiers. You're attaching invalid qualifiers to mole one approach. And it's bullshit. What it really comes down to is you don't have the balls, man. Let's call a spade, man. Let's call a spade, man. A lot of you motherfuckers don't have the balls, man, to be mole one. And see, that's what I respect about my clients and followers. Like most of my clients who I do email consultations with, regular or semi-regular email consultations with, regular, semi-regular Skype and telephone consultations with, and guys who I do one-on-one face-to-face coaching sessions like I did in LA just a few days ago. See, the guys who I work with as my paying clients, they admit to me. They don't try to hide the shit. They don't come to me and basically say, Alan, I don't have the balls to be mole one, and that's why I want to pay you to help me develop the balls to be mole one. And see, that's what I respect, is guys who own up to the fact that they are not at a level yet where they truly have the confidence and courage to be mole one. I respect that, when you just own up to it and admit the shit. But man, I can't stand you motherfuckers who try to deny it and try to act like there's something wrong with my approach and try to poke nitpicky holes in my approach when the reality is you just don't have the balls, man. And I'm going to be even more hardcore in my assessment. And I know I'm going to ruffle some feathers when I stake this comment the way I'm going to state it. But I'm going to tell you, man, there's no such thing as a fucking indirect alpha male. Let me say that again. There's no such thing as a fucking indirect alpha male. That's a fucking oxymoron. You understand that? Some of you guys crack me up trying to either say or imply that you're an alpha male, but yet you will criticize the notion of being verbally direct with women. Nigga, see, I had to use the N-word. I didn't want to use that. Man, alpha male, being an alpha male is all about balls and backbone. All about balls and backbone. It's all about a fearless, I mean fearless sense of confidence and courage. Fearless sense of confidence and courage. If you're scared to say anything to a woman, how the fuck can you call yourself an alpha male? How? Explain it to me like I'm a fucking fifth grader. Explain it to me like I'm a fifth grader. You approach a woman and you engage in 30 minutes of bullshit, flattering, entertaining small talk, but yet you want to refer to yourself as an alpha male? Get the fuck out of here. Get the fuck out of here. You ain't nobody's alpha male. You ain't nobody's alpha male. Again, it's an oxymoron to call yourself an alpha male and then turn around and either highly endorse indirect approaches or criticize direct approaches. You ain't no fucking alpha male. And I would take it even another step further. You ain't red pill either. There's a lot of motherfuckers who want to call themselves red pill, but yet they'll take pot shots at a direct approach and try to argue that being indirect is better. How the fuck you call yourself red pill if you're all about indirect? You ain't no red pill. You, at best, you purple pill. You ain't red pill. Or I would say, if nothing else, your definition of those two things is far different than mine. That's what I'll say. If nothing else, at bare minimum, I would say your definition of those two things is far different than mine. Let's start with alpha. Here is my definition of an alpha male as it relates to dealing with women. An alpha male, at minimum, I would say there's more characteristics than this, but if I had to narrow it down to three characteristics, it would be this. An alpha male is somebody who is fearlessly confident. Fearlessly confident. Fearlessly confident. Number two, somebody who is extremely masculine. Highly masculine in terms of his demeanor and disposition and verbal delivery. He's very masculine. Third thing, he's very erotically dominant. Erotically dominant. Fearlessly confident, extremely masculine, and very dominant, particularly sexually dominant. That's my definition of an alpha. Now, if you got a different definition of alpha, hey, more power to you. I'm telling you Alan Roger Currie's definition of alpha. Again, and there's actually more characteristics I could add on to those three, but I narrow it down to those three. Fearlessly confident, very masculine, and dominant, which all play into being direct. How can you be indirect and call yourself fearlessly confident? Seriously, again, explain that to me like I'm a fifth grader. How can you be indirect and at the same time consider yourself fearlessly confident? Matter of fact, if I have to bring his name up again, alpha male, speaking of alpha male strategies. If you remember that last video I did in 2018, when I talked about the five contradictions of AMS, that was one of the things I attacked him on, man. That was one of his contradictions. He had one video, one comment where he was talking about the Me Too thing. In one breath, he criticized the direct approach and said he doesn't recommend a direct approach because it's too risky in the Me Too movement era. But then he had another video where he said, I don't give a fuck about the Me Too movement era because, you know, essentially he said he was fearlessly confident. And I challenged him on that. I said, how can you call yourself fearlessly confident with women, but yet you're always taking jabs at the direct approach? That's a contradiction. If you're indirect, you ain't fearlessly confident. If you're scared to talk about sex in the very first conversation with a woman, you're not fearlessly confident. You're not courageous. You're not fearlessly confident. You're scared of being rejected. You're scared of negative reactions. That's not fearlessly confident. That's a verbal coward. In blunt terms, you're a verbal coward. You can try to make justifications, excuses. You're a verbal coward. Period. highly masculine about being indirect? Huh? What's highly masculine about engaging in 45 minutes of bullshit small talk? What's highly masculine about that? And how can you show your dominance to a woman while you're talking about the weather or talking about politics or talking about your favorite movies or your favorite foods? How can you really display your dominance? Huh? Fuck out of here. Now on to red pill. What does it mean? You know, I've done multiple videos about the definition of red pill versus blue pill versus purple pill versus black pill. Red pill is when you have a thorough understanding about women's true sexual nature, about women's true sexual nature, and about women's true manipulative and materialistic nature. That's when you're red pill, is when you have a thorough understanding of women's true sexual nature, number one, and number two, women's true manipulative and materialistic nature. That's red pill. How can you call yourself a red pill motherfucker if you being indirect with women? Again, explain that to me like I'm a fifth grader. At best, you're being purple pill if you're being indirect with women. You're being purple pill. Again, for those of you who forgot, purple pill is when you have red pill knowledge, red pill awareness, but when you talk to other people, and particularly talk to women, you basically more or less pretend like you're still of the blue pill mindset. You're still of the blue. I'll give you a quick example of being purple pill. Let's say you knew that most women were sexual enough to fuck on the first date. You knew they were sexual enough to fuck on the first date, but instead of just coming at them like with an attitude like, I knew you would give me the pussy on the first date, you say something like, hey, Linda, why don't we go out to a couple lunch dates and maybe a dinner date and get to know each other and see how things go. See, that would be you being purple pill, man. If you know women are down to potentially down to fuck on the first date, but you're suggesting that you go on two or three dates, I mean, why the fuck would you do that? Really, why the fuck would you go on a date, period, if you know you can fuck a woman without going on a date? I mean, seriously, why would you invite a woman out on a date when you know you can fuck a woman without a date? Again, I'm going to repeat again, man. Do you know I've never gone on a date with a woman for casual sex, ever? When my objective is strictly casual sex, I never go on dates with women. I just hook up with them. What's known as, in the 21st century, is the hookup culture. Surely most of you have heard that term, the hookup culture. And a lot of people have talked about how the hookup culture has replaced the idea of traditional dating. I don't go on dates, like lunch dates, dinner dates with women when I know I just want to fuck them. The only time I go on lunch dates, dinner dates, or just formal type dates with women is if I look at a woman as a potential long-term girlfriend. Somebody I'm going to deal with long-term. It might even be a long-term non-monogamous lover. But I know I'm going to be dealing with them long-term. That's the only time I really go on dates with women. But if I know my interest is more short-term, like say a one-night stand, a weekend fling, or 2, 3, 4 weeks of just casual sex, I don't go on no dates with no women, man. I don't invite no woman on no date. I just let women know I want to fuck them. Because I got coconut-sized balls. Well, not literally, but figuratively speaking, that would be fucked up in my pants if I had coconut-sized balls, literally. But everybody know I got big-ass balls, man. I ain't scared to say shit to a woman, man. Because I ain't no verbal coward, man. But again, a lot of you guys try to make excuses and justifications for your lack of balls. And I'm going to go back to the two main things. Here's the funny thing. Speaking of balls, again, I mentioned this on at least one other recent video. The things, the characteristics and attributes you should be attaching to direct, you don't. And the things you should not be attaching to direct, you do. Example, If I was to hear a guy say, Mo 1 is only beneficial for guys with big ass balls, see, I wouldn't have a problem with that. If somebody came in my comment section and said that, or I heard somebody say that on a video, I wouldn't have a problem with that statement because that's the truth. That's the truth. If somebody said, yeah, Mo 1, I think Mo 1 is only really beneficial for guys with big ass balls. See, that's when you ain't gonna get no argument out of me because that's the truth. I think Mo 1 only works for guys who are fearlessly confident. Oh, you wouldn't get no argument out of me on that because that's the truth. Mo 1 is only for guys who have a BDSM dom background and are really erotically dominant. I wouldn't 100% agree with that, but you wouldn't get no argument out of me either, though. Like, I'll tell you something that, since I brought up his name already, I'll bring him again. Alpha Male Strategy said about Mo 1 that I didn't 100% agree with, but at the same time, I didn't 100% disagree with it either, is when we did that panel discussion with O'Shea Duke Jackson last year around Memorial Day weekend, Alpha Male Strategy said, I think that Mo 1 is best suited for guys who are naturally charismatic and have a natural sense of persuasive and seductive charm. Now, on one hand, I wouldn't say I 100% agree with that assessment, but at the same time, and I think I said this on the show, I don't 100% disagree with that either. And again, that relates to actually my one-on-one face-to-face coaching sessions. That's one of the things I help men develop and enhance, is their sense of persuasive charm and seductive influence with women. So I would say I at least partially agree. See, people think I always disagree with Alpha Male Strategies, but on that point, I actually at least half agree with him. When he said, yeah, he basically had said in that panel discussion, he said, I don't know if Mo 1 would benefit a guy who has absolutely no charisma or no sense of like persuasive and seductive charm. And to a certain extent, I would at least halfway agree with that. So those examples of things that if people were to say, I wouldn't necessarily disagree. Here's the two main things, you know, I think you know the two main things I do disagree with. Is when guys say Mo 1 is only beneficial for guys who are exceptionally good looking. That's bullshit. And again, I've said that multiple times already, so this ain't nothing new, but I'm saying it again. That's bullshit. That's bullshit. I know a lot of guys who are, including a lot of my clients, who are average looking or even slightly below average looking that have benefited from being Mo 1. So the thing about the looks, that's bullshit. That's bullshit. And here's the thing. If you're amazingly good looking, why do you need to be Mo 1? I mean, keeping it real, why do you need to be Mo 1 if you're amazingly good looking? I mean, you could be Mo 1, but my question is, why do you need, cute emphasis on the word need, why do you need to be Mo 1? Remember, I've been recently talking about the concept my brother came up with called mode zero, and even Ron Wills used this term before, mode zero. If you're amazingly good looking, let's say you look a brother, if you're a black dude, you look like Boris Kojo, or white dude, you look like Brad Pitt. I mean, if you look like Brad Pitt or Boris Kojo, shit, you can get away with being Mo 2. Shit, you could probably get away with being Mo 3 and still get some pussy. Why do you need to be Mo 1 if you're amazingly good looking? Why? Same with wealth. Second thing is guys who say, and this is even with me and Donovan Sharp. Again, we cool again now. But speaking of that Memorial Day panel discussion, this is one of the things that caused me and Donovan Sharp to have a brief, at least a 24 to 48 hour falling out. Because Donovan Sharp argued that the main guys that Mo 1 would benefit would be guys who are wealthy. Yeah, he said some comment to the fact of, he said, I think Mo 1 will only work for you if you like, you know, making like 6 or 7 figures. If you're wealthy, why do you need to be Mo 1? You could just buy some pussy. You can just resort to tricking and whining and dining. What do you need to be mode one for? I would say, if anything, it's just the opposite. Mode one is broke man's game. And y'all have heard me say that before, particularly in 2017. I did a few videos where I talked about that. Like, see, when I was in my 20s, man, I couldn't afford to take a woman on three dates. I think some of y'all think I'd be joking when I talk about how broke I was. I think some of y'all think I'd be, like, exaggerating. Y'all might be thinking I just didn't have as much money as I wanted to have. No, I was broke. I'm talking about, like, I couldn't go on three $25 to $30 dates on a woman. I was broke. There were weeks in my 20s where I didn't even have, like, $20 to my name. And I'm not even joking. I didn't even have, like, $20 to my name. That's how broke I was. I couldn't afford to be taking women out on two or three dates. And sometimes I didn't even have enough money to take a woman out on one, like, $25 date. I had to be more one to get laid. It wasn't an option. What's that movie from? What's the movie where somebody says, this is not an option, motherfucker. This is not an option, motherfucker. Going out on dates for me a lot of times was not even an option. Unless the woman was going to pay for it, which I did have some women pay for my dates when I was in my 20s and 30s. Yeah, I actually had quite a few women pay for dates. More of you should demand. On a side note, you know, I always say, you should charge women for your non-sexual attention and companionship. If all y'all going to be doing is talking and you're going to be providing a woman with your non-sexual attention and companionship, you should be charging her for that. You know my credo, no free attention. That's Alan Roger Curry credo. No free attention, man. No free attention. So, yeah, my attitude is, if you're going out on a date with a woman and you feel like there's a greater than 75% chance you ain't going to end up fucking, I would suggest that the woman pay for the fucking date. Yeah, when I was in my 20s and 30s, I'd say no less than 40 to 50% of the time I went on dates with women, they paid for it. Yeah, they paid for it. But my point was, for guys who say, Mo1 only works for wealthy guys, what the fuck you need to be Mo1 if you got a lot of money? Again, you could just resort to tricking and or whining and dining if you got a bunch of money. Oh, and that brings me to another note, and then I'll wrap up on this. I had another person ask me about, if you remember when I did the video, response video to the guy, Afi, I think his name is, Afi or Afi Kingdom. He made one of those comments, Mo1 only works for this type of guy. He said, I think Mo1 only works for guys if the woman has a high interest in you. And in the last couple of days, somebody wrote me talking about the whole high, I think they mentioned Alpha Male Strategies too. Yeah, because you know, Alpha Male Strategies talks about that. So him and Afi Kingdom have that in common. They basically always talk about interest in terms of, they basically divide in three categories: high interest, average or medium interest, or less than average or low interest. And both of them make the argument that direct approach is only beneficial if a woman has high interest in you. But they make the argument that if a woman has average or medium interest in you, or less than average or low interest in you, then it's better to be indirect. And I already mentioned that I disagree with that. But like I told this person when I replied to him, and I'm going to say it here, even though I don't disagree per se with those categories, high, medium, and low, I don't look at interest like that. And it's, most of you all should know already how I look at interest. Here's how I define interest. Speaking of the 21 convention, I talked about this actually last year at the 2018 21 convention. This was part of my speaking presentation. I talked about the different types of interest. For me, there's four types of interest. Four types of interest. But I don't evaluate in terms of high, medium versus low. Here's how I look at interest. And this relates to a video I actually already did, the one called Fuck Buddy versus Husband, Boyfriend versus Platonic Friend. And if I had that on one more, versus Trick and Sugar Daddy. Here's my four level interest. Number one is what I call just genuine lust. Sexual interest is representative of just genuine sexual lust. Or another way of putting it is casual sex interests. Casual sex interests. Both men and women have that. That ain't specific to women. That ain't specific to men. Men, we all know that there's some women we might meet and we'll say, man, I just want to fuck her casually, but I don't want her to be my future wife or my next long-term girlfriend. I just want to fuck her casually. Women have the same thing. Women have that same type of interest. There's some guys that women meet. That's why I always talk about how women will make the comment, we know who we want to fuck just to be fucking. I can't tell you how many women have made that comment to me. They'll say, Alan, us women, we know who we want to fuck just to be fucking. That's their way of saying that we know there's only a certain percentage of men that we want to have casual sex with. That we want to have casual sex with. That's my number one type of interest, is would be genuine lust interest, or put another way, casual sex interest. Then the second type of interest is what I simply call romantic interest. Romantic sexual interest. Romantic sexual interest is when a woman only wants to have sex with you if she can also have access to your non-sexual time, attention, and companionship. That's romantic sexual interest. Is when a woman only is willing to have sex with you if she can also have equal, if not greater, access to your non-sexual time, attention, and companionship. And on a quick side note, see, that's where the concept of indirect comes into play. That's why a lot of guys are indirect. What a lot of guys do is they present themselves as if they're interested in a romantic sexual interest relationship with a woman. But then once they get the pussy, they end up making it clear that they really just wanted casual sex. See, that's one of the most greatest, you know, manipulative head games that men run on women, is making it appear like they have romantic sexual interests. And then after they get the pussy 2 times, 5 times, 10 times, 15 times, then they end up revealing to the woman that they really just wanted casual sex. See, I'm not down with that shit, man. But yeah, that's the second type of interest, is romantic sexual interest. The third type of interest is what I call manipulative, opportunistic, or money-based sexual interest. Manipulative, opportunistic, or money-based sexual interest. A quick nickname for that would be simply sugar daddy slash trick type sexual interest. Sugar daddy slash trick type sexual interest. That's basically when a woman is only willing to have sex with you if you're going to provide her with some type of financial compensation, financial favors, materialistic gifts, pay her bills, etc. Basically what I call negotiation, negotiated, financially negotiated sex. That's the third type of interest, is manipulative, opportunistic. Or what I mean by opportunistic, it couldn't even be money. It could be an employment offer. Like a woman, if you own your own company and a woman wants to either work for your company, or she already works for your company and she wants to get a promotion and she's willing to give you some pussy in exchange for a promotion. See, that's opportunistic. That's what I would call opportunistic sex. So that's the third type of sexual interest that I have in my book, is manipulative slash opportunistic slash money-based sexual interest. And then the fourth and final interest would be either simply what I call either no interest at all, or purely platonic interest, which essentially is the same thing. No sexual interest at all, or purely platonic interest. Because if a woman is only interested in your purely platonic companionship, that essentially means she has no interest in having sex with you at all. She has no interest in having sex with you at all. So again, in terms of looking at interest in terms of high versus medium versus low interest, I look at interest in terms of genuine lustful interest, genuine sexual lustful interest, or what I also call casual sex interest, romantic sexual interest, which means a woman is only willing to have sex with you if she can also have access to your non-sexual time, attention, and companionship. manipulative slash opportunistic slash money-based sexual interest, which means a woman is only willing to have sex with you if she's going to gain some tangible value out of the deal, something she's going to receive something or gain something of tangible value, and more specifically of financial or materialistic value out of the deal. And finally, there's no interest at all slash purely platonic interest. That's how I evaluate interest. That's how I, Alan Roger Currie, evaluates interest in those four categories. Those four categories. All right, fellas. For my Patreon subscribers, I got my second Patreon exclusive live stream on Thursday at 4 o'clock p.m. Eastern. Thursday at 4 o'clock p.m. Eastern. Until then, quit making excuses and justifications for being a verbal coward. Own up to it. Just say to me, man, have some balls for once in your life and just have the balls to say, Alan, I'm a verbal coward. I don't have the balls to be my one. That's all you need to say. Instead of all these nitpicky criticisms and all this other bullshit, just simply say, hey, man, I'm going to just be real. I'm going to keep shit 1,000 with you, Alan. I don't have the balls to be my one with women, man. I don't have the balls. That's why I choose to be indirect. It's because I don't have the confidence and courage and balls and backbone to be my one. Because that's the truth. Whether y'all want to admit it or not, openly acknowledge it or not, that's what the truth is. It ain't got nothing to do with this bullshit like you got to have looks, you got to have money and all this other bullshit. You don't have the fucking balls to be my one. Own up to that shit.
You know, it's the tone of your voice, how seductive your intonations are, the vibrations that you could just reach out over the phone lines and stroke a woman's breast just by the sound of your voice, how you could make her pussy so wet just by the sound of your voice. That's actually very hot.
So you said my show was what?
I said your show is powerful.
Oh, say it again.
Your show is powerful.
I bet the king would fuck me really good.
Oh, yeah. Who's the king?
Alan Roger Currie.
Oh, yeah. Who's the king?
Alan Roger Currie. The king.
The king.
The king. The king.